I would like to share with you a personal story. I worked with John McDermott, Marvin Minsky, and other artificial intelligence gurus on the topic of easy programming. How can we, people who do not know how to program, how we could actually create those applications ourselves? You know, if you're a scientist, researcher, there are tools, and actually Henry worked on those many years ago. I don't want to mention how many years ago, but and he created something called visual debugger. So when you write programs, you have to slowly get them to do what you really want. And that's called debugging, yes? Which reminds me of another problem. We have to work on software methodologies still now. It's a very relevant issue. Quality of healthcare will depend on software. So we wouldn't have to have constant quality control of software healthcare organizations if we develop software methodologies that will assure no bugs. So removing bugs as a permanent and accepted part of software, we just have to get rid of bugs. And debugging, visual debugger was supposed to make programming very easy. And I admired Henry's work in that area. Then I learned that he does work on intelligent agents and more. Henry Lieberman is a research scientist at MIT Computer Science and Artificial Intelligence Laboratory, where he's starting the Marvin Minsky Center for Artificial Intelligence. That's the great thing that will move us forward. He also holds an appointment as a visiting scientist at the MIT Media Laboratory. His interests are in the intersection of artificial intelligence and human-computer interaction to make computers smarter and more helpful to people. At the Media Lab since 1987, he directed the Media Lab Software Agents Group and as principal research scientist. He has published 3 books and over 120 research articles. He holds a doctoral equivalent degree from University of Paris. Welcome, and the future is yours.
Thank you, Renata. That was a great lead-in, talking about reasoning by analogy and talking about debugging, hacker slang for doctors. Hackers often refer to doctors as body debuggers. So you say, my back hurts, I have to go see the body debugger. Okay, so my talk is about from society of mind to society of body. So society of mind was the title of the book by one of my and Renata's mentors, the great Marvin Minsky, who unfortunately died just recently. I want to apologize. I was not here yesterday. I was in New York. So I know there was a panel talking about Marvin. So you'll forgive me if I repeat. I don't know what was said, so I might repeat some things. Two of Marvin's greatest books are The Society of Mind and The Emotion Machine. And I think there's a lot of very, very important lessons to be learned for medicine, and I'll try to convey a few. So let's start with the idea of society of mind. So if you say, I went to a medical conference today, well, just who is that I? Right. If you're trying to think about how the mind works, you can't explain how the mind works just by talking about the idea of a self or ego, because then you have to explain that and break it up into little parts. Right. So Marvin's idea was called the Society of Mind, and his idea was that the mind is made up of a set of cooperating and competing parts. The brain is the hardware. The mind is the software. So to understand it, you ask the same questions that you would ask about how a piece of software works, namely, what does it do, and how do the parts communicate? So there's division of labor, hierarchy, goals, plans, and debugging. So we want to bring those notions into thinking about the medical field. So here's a quote from a Society of Mind where he explains what the idea is. I won't read it, but the idea is that if you're trying to pick up a cup of tea, then you have to grasp, you have to balance, you have to think about is the tea too hot or too cold. And all these considerations are done by little software agents inside your head, that run on the hardware of the brain. And what you want to think about is how they communicate and cooperate to drink the tea. And you can just drink a cup of tea without thinking about it. So let's take society of mind and start to think about society of body. What does that mean? Well, it means the body is composed of a set of systems that cooperate and also compete to a certain extent. There's multiple perspectives. And one of the famous quotes of Marvin is, if you understand something only in one way, you don't understand it at all. So you have to think about what the functions are and how the different pieces of the brain or the mind. And I understand that in traditional Chinese medicine, there's not so much the division about thinking about the mind and the body. You think about it as one system from multiple perspectives, and I think we need to adopt that. And there's a layered architecture. So I'm going to talk about, depending on how much time I have, four ideas from the society of mind: common sense knowledge, analogical reasoning that Renata did some very seminal work in, and she also talked about this idea of multiple perspectives, and then a concept that Marvin called the ways to think, which is a little bit subtle, but we'll talk about that maybe at the end if there's time. Okay, Marvin also talked about a six-layer architecture for the mind. And at the lowest level, there's just reflexes or reactive stuff. Above that, there's deliberative level, reflective level, self-reflective, self-conscious, and self-ideals. So you can think also about how this works in medicine. So we have a reactive layer. If you, the body has very quick reactions, blinking, nervous reactions. If you bang somebody's knee with a hammer, it jerks. Okay. So those operate on a very small time scale. And then we have chemicals that operate on longer time scales. And then finally, at the top level, the goal of medicine is to have people have healthy and happy lives. And so you have to figure out, you also have to understand what a person's life is like and how the functions of their body fit into their life. And that's very important. So you can't ignore a person's life. Another idea from Marvin is what he called the causal diversity matrix. So the method, so you organize problems as the number of causes versus the number of effects. Okay. And if you have only very few causes and effects, then you can use very straight line logical reasoning. But it's brittle because if that one way doesn't work, nothing's left. Okay. At the other end, if you have many causes and many effects, you could do statistical or probabilistic reasoning. Okay. But then that kind of reasoning, it's hard to explain what's going on because there's too many causes and too many effects. So the kind of sweet spot is the stuff in red that Marvin talked about, things like case-based reasoning and analogy, where you have a moderate number of causes and effects, and you can use multiple perspectives to understand what their interactions is. In 2000, Marvin wrote a book called, an article rather, called Common Sense-Based Interfaces in the Communications of the ACM that said that if we're ever going to make our user interfaces work well, they have to have common sense knowledge. And now I'm going to talk a little bit about, and so here's just a few characteristics of what's different about logical knowledge, or what we call data, right? And common sense knowledge. So, you know, logical or factual knowledge is very precise. Common sense knowledge is vague. You might have a formal language or a formal database for expressing logical truths, but you express common sense in natural language. And then this last one is very interesting and important. If you have a database or you have some logical knowledge, you can organize stuff up front into very neat little categories, okay? Then it's easy to use, right? So you do upfront organization, but common sense knowledge, you have to think about on the back end. So you just throw it in any which way you can get it, and then it's the back end that really organizes it. So we're not so interested in absolute truth as we are as something plausible. Could it be true? Can I think of reasons why it could be true? That's what we're after. So for about a decade, I've worked with some of my students and colleagues, Catherine Avesi, Rob Spear, on a project called Open Mind Common Sense, where we crowdsourced a set of knowledge. We just asked people to say in sentences what they knew about common everyday objects, including some health topics. So here's what we know about aspirin. Aspirin is a cheap drug. Aspirin relieves headaches. Aspirin is acetyl salicylic acid. Okay, and these are just random facts. And none of them are very precise, but they constitute what an ordinary person would know about the concept of aspirin. Okay. We organize that into a knowledge base called ConceptNet. Okay, and concept. So, what do we know about eating breakfast? Well, before you eat breakfast, you have to wake up. After it, you have a full stomach. It takes place in the kitchen, right? And all this stuff is not represented in traditional computer systems, but we want to represent this. It's the knowledge the doctor has in their head. Okay, now I'm going to show you an application of it in the medical field. And the idea is that we need to balance flexibility and constraints when we're interviewing patients. If we just ask patients to fill out questionnaires, or if we think of a patient as just a set of medical data, we're missing a lot. Okay, and in a hospital, there's something called the McGill Pain Questionnaire. So it has, you know, 16 categories of pain, including lacerating pain. You can't interact with patients that way. You know, it doesn't make sense, right? What is a patient says, doctor, it feels like there's an elephant on my chest. Okay, so what do we know about elephants? Elephants are gray. Well, that doesn't help. Elephants live in India. That doesn't help either. Elephants are big and heavy. Oh, yeah, well, that has to do with pressure. And pressure, so now we can, talk about, it's pressure, pain, it's diffuse pain, it might intensify over time, and then we can put it in the questionnaire. So we have John Moore was a doctor that I was working with, and we took unconstrained natural language and we turned it into a precise knowledge in the pain questionnaire. So if you say, my pain is like a knife, we had an on-screen agent that said, well, I know that a knife is sharp. Is that what you mean, that the knife is sharp? Okay, but if you say something out of the box, like my pain is like a chainsaw, okay, what does that mean? Well, chainsaws, what's the purpose of a chainsaw? Well, a chainsaw cuts things, okay, but it's a little bit different than a knife. So the pain might be a little vibrating because a chainsaw vibrates. So understanding all this stuff is a very, very important part of, a doctor not only takes data, right? But they also listen to the patient, and details from the patient's life help them understand the situation. And their job is to translate it into medically useful knowledge. When we work with big data or in the past expert systems, they've typically ignored common sense knowledge, and it's a really, really important part. This is a quote from John McCarthy about Meissen, which was one of the earliest expert systems. And it said, Meissen's ontology, it has data for bacteria, symptoms, tests, infection sites, antibiotics, and so forth. But it doesn't know what a doctor is. It doesn't know what a hospital is. It doesn't know why a person wouldn't want to be sick. Okay, so we have to bring all that stuff into the medical process. Okay, one thing also we want to work on during the future is what we call not so common sense knowledge. So common sense knowledge is the knowledge we all share, right? But it can be divided up into smaller things where, so you could say, what is the common sense of a first year medical student? What is the common sense of gastrointestinal specialists? And this isn't all the way towards expert systems. It's not the most complicated knowledge that you have, but it's kind of a base of knowledge. And one of the reasons why expert systems, the original expert systems, didn't work too well is because they were missing that layer of knowledge, and therefore they're brittle. In the current machine learning stuff, it's also missing that kind of knowledge. So it's also going to have a certain brittleness that we're going to have to deal with. So even if the machine learning and the statistics tell you something, the doctor and the patient still have to understand it well enough to have confidence in it and to be able to make use of it. So we need to represent that layer. We have a certain inference technique that we call analogy space, which arranges all the concepts we have into dimensions like good or bad or big or small, depending on kind of aggregating these little bits of common sense knowledge. I'll skip along a little bit here. Okay, and I just want to tell you about a couple of projects that we're working on now that have to do with this idea of representing perspective. In particular, my student Karthik Dinakar is working on trying to bring the idea of multiple perspectives into machine learning. So in typical machine learning, it's real. Everybody loves it because you can just put a lot of big data and you can press a button and get an answer. The problem is you can only press that button once. Okay, and if you're trying to understand, and typically that what you get when you press that button is kind of an amalgam of all the perspectives that went into that data set, the perspectives of every doctor, every patient, and it's all just kind of blended together, right? But you may need to separate out different people's perspectives. What's the doctor's perspective? What's the patient's perspective? What's the specialist or a generalist? So we are developing a general technique called lensing to bring perspective, multiple perspectives into machine learning. Okay, and the way lensing works is you run some machine learning procedure. Okay, and then it gives, and you know, you have to remember that when you yesterday there was a talk on somebody, a lady at Children's Hospital, who was talking about using machine learning to analyze text of doctor-patient interactions. Right, and that's good. We're doing that as well. But what you have to remember is that in the machine learning paradigm, it doesn't really understand natural language. It's just using a bag of words. Okay, and somehow you got to turn that bag of words into a meaningful concept for people. Okay, so what we have is we make an interactive machine learning loop. Okay, where we take some of the words that come out of the machine learning analysis, and then we feed it back to experts or people with, you can feed it back to people with different perspectives, and then you can ask them what's going on here, okay? And then they can respond in unconstrained natural language, okay? And then you can feed that back into the machine learning process. You can have an interactive loop, okay? And it can be done differently for people with different perspectives. And by doing that, you can be able to get different perspectives on the same, what looks like just one set of data. Okay, and we're applying that in several interesting applications in mental health and in cardiology. So we're working with Matthew Nock at Harvard on depression and suicide and self-harm. And we're working with a social network called Talk Life, where people with mental distress, they go and talk about their problems and what they might do. And we're analyzing some of this stuff, and we're maybe trying to adjust the news feeds that they see. We're trying to look for indicators of people who might have more serious problems or may be at risk for attempting suicide. And we've had very, very good results with this so far. It very much outperforms some of the statistical measures of risk that have been used previously. Then there's also a project which I find very exciting on cardiolinguistics. So we're working with Catherine Kritsoulas, who's a Canadian researcher that has worked on a problem of diagnosis of cardiac problems in women. There's been a lot of misdiagnosis and underdiagnosis of cardiac problems in women because 95% of cardiologists are male. A lot of research is done with male subjects only. Okay, and they look for the Hollywood heart, what they call the Hollywood heart attack, where a man, you know, clutches their heart and keels over. Whereas a lot of women don't express the symptoms the same way. Now, there's a big question of, do they have different symptoms, what's called atypical angina, or do they just express the symptoms differently? And Dr. Kritsoulas has shown that really it's about expressing the systems differently and how the doctors understand it. There's some great research that shows that. So what we're doing is, and then the actual physiology is determined by the angiograms, is very similar or exactly the same. Okay, so there's a big problem of misdiagnosis, and we're applying these multiple perspectives. We can take the doctor's perspective, which may be biased male, and we can take the patient's perspective, which may be more female. We can understand the modes of expression that each are using, and then we can apply it to the same sets of data and hopefully save a lot of lives of women who may otherwise be misdiagnosed. So I'll stop there for time, and I just want to leave you with the idea that the society of mind, multiple perspectives, common sense knowledge, analogical reasoning is an important idea for the medical field, and let's work on the society of the body. Thank you.